Hello and welcome to module 5 of this interesting program on business data analytics using Power BI. My name is Rupam and I welcome you all on behalf of Level Up. So Level Up is here for you to give you the best in class coaching, mentoring and consulting. So welcome to the session, and we are now in module number 5. So module 5, we will talk about the modeling of data, which is the most important part after preparation of the data. So we would talk about how to model the data and how do we build expressions. So which expressions are we talking about? So that we will talk in detail in this particular session, in this particular module. Let's have a quick understanding of the agenda. So this particular module is divided into again 3 parts. So part 1, we will talk about the basic techniques and the dimensional modeling that we perform. And then, I mean, the complex models that occur in Power BI. So introduction to DAX we will be doing. And what is DAX used for? And then we will be seeing how to make a container to store measures and why do we make a container. So that will be covered in part 1 of module 5. In part 2, we will be looking into few DAX functions. So DAX functions actually relate to, let's say, date, time, intelligence functions and all. So we will see how to aggregate data using DAX. And also we will be seeing how to actually handle time periods, or let's say, take an example, how do we filter data. So all these things we will be seeing in part 2 of this particular module. We will then move on to some of the statistical functions to enhance your data and understand, okay, what is data lineage? I mean, how the data is flowing from one place to another and how DAX makes an impact over there. And finally, we will see in an activity that, okay, how do we create a calendar using DAX? I mean, we will see what are the different types of DAX that are created and we will have a quick look at it. So let's begin the show. First of all, we need to understand that why do we do data modeling? I mean, after preparation of the data, we think that, okay, directly now we can go ahead and then visualize. Right. So where is modeling comes into picture in this entire system? So we need to understand that always data will not be or might not be coming from one source in the sense. So suppose if you're talking about data coming from Excel, so it may be possible that data is coming from sometimes data coming from Excel, sometimes data coming from, let's say, SAP, sometimes coming from Oracle, sometimes coming from Microsoft SQL Server. So data has many forms actually. And why we are using this particular tool is to handle this complexity, handle these different types of data and bring them to one single place to work. So it is also a good practice to have an understanding throughout across the, I would say the landscape of the data that you are ingesting into the system. And obviously, it gives us a better understanding of the business process that, okay, what is the data lineage, how data is flowing from one place to another. So that's the purpose. That's the purpose of why we create DAX or why we create data model in first place. So DAX is just a part of it. We will be discussing it in short while. So when we say that, okay, we are creating data models, we are always talking about the concept of calculations. So calculations needs to be done within this particular data. So the first calculation, so majorly, if anybody says that, okay, are we performing any calculations, are we performing any type of let's say aggregation and all these things into our data, so we say that we do it majorly in two ways. So either we are creating calculated columns, which we are going to see, everything we are going to see in detail in this particular session, or we are creating actually measures. So columns and measures. Now, measures to some extent, we have seen one example in Excel as well, that how it is done. I mean, just some very basic aggregation, but here we will be seeing it in detail. Calculated columns, I would say that, okay, some of the things you have already done and learned in Excel as well. So we will be moving to the next phase over here, right? So we will see how to take that to the next level. And so to give you some simple examples. So sometimes, I mean, you might face this challenge that, okay, where to use calculated column and where to use measures. So the first and foremost thing is that use your calculated columns where you feel that there is one answer per row. So suppose one row is giving you one value. That is where you use a calculated column. So it is like on a table you are using. But when it comes to measures, these measures can be used globally. Globally in the sense that entire model can represent one value. That is the power of these measures, right? One more thing, what happens is when you are using calculated columns, they are computed and calculated when you are refreshing the data. So when the data is getting loaded into your Power BI, at that time itself, it is computed and calculated. Whereas in terms of your measures, they are handled runtime. So runtime based on whatever you are pulling, bringing and all these things. So that is where your measures comes into picture. So usually when you talk about calculated columns, they are associated with a table. So they are obviously associated with a table. And when it comes to measures, so they can be calculated. They can be calculated based on multiple tables also. So these are the basic differences, right? So the major techniques, if I may say that, okay, how does this relational thing works? So let me just open up my session notes and then just give you a very basic concept. So, I mean, when you say data modeling, so data modeling, we need to understand that it is completely a layer on top of your prepared data. Prepared data means cleaned data. That's why in this particular session, in this particular part of the program, we will take help of the earlier ERP data that we have already gathered and cleansed, right? So we will not be repeating that entire thing. So we will take it from there. So modeling starts after cleansing, right? So that's how it works. And when we say modeling, so suppose one part definitely would be DAX, but before the DAX comes into picture, what we need to see is that what are my dimensions and facts? Because DAX is all about creating the measures. So creating the measures will only come when you know and when you have a clear idea about the dimensions and the facts. So in a there are different models that we have, for data, right? So the most commonly used model is the snowflakes schema, what we call it. So here what happens is that we divide, here we might have to talk about the Quartz rule, right? So according to Quartz rule, each and every, whenever you are dividing a database or when you are, let's say, building up a database rather to say, so you need to follow some rules. So follow some rules in terms of what? In terms of tables, right? In terms of columns, in terms of rows. So this is actually a bigger part which is covered in SQL Server and the SQL training program. But I'm just giving you some basic idea. So according to Quartz rule, all these columns and attributes should be connected with the tables, and tables are interconnected to make the database. Right? That's the fundamental idea. So here also what happens is when you are defining the facts and the dimensions, so there is a middle section which is the fact, and all the dimensions are moving around that particular fact. That is how the snowflake. So what happens is, if you think that, okay, the one fact is not able to cater to all the dimensions, what we do is we bring up another fact out of that particular data. So we will see those all things in detail. So we might have to copy one fact or one dimension to cater to this system of schema or whatever we call it, right? So now, basically, most of the cases you will see that the data is arranged. First of all, we have the data item. Then we have the related data, which is the column, and in the form of a row. So when you say row, row is nothing but a related arrangement of your data items, you can say. They are related, obviously. So everywhere the word related will come. So that is how the schema also is defined primarily. Then what happens is that most of the cases, you will also notice that you will have some scope of doing some calculations on top of your column. So suppose the columns have been assigned already. So suppose you need to do a discount offer in terms of an ERP data in some products table. So those are the calculated ones, the additional columns that you put within a table. So that is also an important part, right? Okay. So when you say, now when you talk about the relation over there, so we need to make sure that we are talking about two contexts. One is called filter context and one is called row context. So the one that we just discussed, that we need to create calculated columns, so actually that is called, so that is a part of the row context. And when you make the measures directly, so they are a part of filter context. So these are the two contexts that we are going to see in detail in this particular session. Now often we will see that when you are taking data into Power BI, Power BI has its own engine to identify the relation between these data sets and then build up a model by itself. So we have to focus on this particular part, talking about the lineage. So suppose if you talk about, let's go to our own data set. So what I have done is I have just copied the ERP prep data, which we ended up with in module 4. And I assigned that as a beginning point of module 5 and I'm calling it as ERP data DAX. So the focus will be completely on DAX over here. Okay, so here in this particular section, if you talk about the last section, so we had already defined the dimensions and the facts. So what I was trying to say over here is, if you look at this particular model, now if customers had to talk to products, then the lineage shows something like this. It has to come via the fact orders to the products. So which means that in terms of Power BI, I don't have to define this lineage, or I cannot assume a concept wherein all these tables will be connected directly to another table. So it might not be possible. So what we need to do is, we have to see whether the other table is connected to the third table. So I connect two tables and the second table should be connected to third table, something like this. That's how the lineage concept works over here. So, if I go to the modeling, so we need to manage the relationships and then define the model so that it optimizes the reporting part of it. So, it is all interconnected over here. So, obviously, we need to understand that, okay, in Power BI, these relationships by itself, often you will see that it is getting auto-detected. So that is also a part of the feature of Power BI. And when it gets auto-detected, so there are two basic options. One is one-to-one and another one is many-to-one or one-to-many. So we do not have many to many options. So that becomes an ambiguity. So we will see it in Capstone, our projects that are there in Capstone project. So we will see there how to mitigate this many to many problems and how to see it over there in a part of DAX. So one part, this part is called cardinality. So cardinality again goes back to the chords rule, wherein we talk about how one table is connected to another table. So it could be one to one, which means that one data point, so having a related, so if what I mean, usually if you talk about the cardinality and chords rule, so cardinality, so we have three, one to one, we have one to many, and we have many to many. So many to many we do not use usually. It's a ambiguity that it creates, right? When you have many data points connecting to many data points, doesn't make sense anything. So one to many or many to one, this is the most commonly found example that you will be seeing in our in our projects over here. And when you define the direction of the data, how it is flowing, if you just notice this particular our model over here, so you can see that, so first of all we see that dim products is connected to fact orders, which means that over here fact order is communicating to dim products in case it requires any help or any related data for product ID. So there is a product ID column. If somebody wants what is product ID and to go deeper into product ID, it will communicate to dim products. If you notice over here, there is a small arrow. So this arrow says that data will always flow. The lineage is the data will flow from products to orders and not from orders to products. However, if you look at this particular section wherein we have categories and products, so the lineage says that they both can talk to each other in reverse format as well. So which means that if required, categories will look into products, and if required, products can also look into categories. This is the example that we just saw in our last module session as well. If I double click on this, so here these all things will be revealed. So you can see one, it says cardinality. So cardinality, if you look at it, so it has got four options. So one says many to one, and then we have one to many also. This is almost the same thing. Then we have one to one, so wherein one table of a particular model communicates to another one, and where one record. So I'll just give you an example, because we would definitely like to see examples and then in our thought process. So consider an HR data. So in HR data, so suppose there are two tables. One talks about the basic information of an employee, let's say the personal information, address and date of birth and stuff like this. And there is another table which captures the salary details. So now personal details are kept in one table and salary details are kept in another table, because both of them are separate and they are required by different departments. So let's say the hiring team might require the personal details, but they might not require that complete salary details of that employee. So that is required by the finance team or accounts team, let's say. So then what happens? There need to be a connection between these two tables, right? So that connection would be definitely one to one, because one employee in an organization will have only one related record for the salary, so not multiple. So that is where one to one comes into picture, but most of the cases it will be many to one and one to many. Here in the cross direction, so when we talk about the lineage, so this is very important, that which side data can travel. Here we can see that it is traveling in both direction, but most of the cases you will see that it will travel in single direction. There is one more example, one more checkbox I would say, which talks about the direction. So here it says apply security filter in both directions. So when you apply both directions, so what we need to do is we need to go for this option wherein when you are deploying this solution onto cloud, the security filter should also be applicable in both the directions. So that is what it means. So security filter means, I mean, row level security I'm talking about. So that is where this is used. And then we have this relationship. So right now you can see that the relationship is active. If I just uncheck it and I say okay, you will see that this particular, if I just may zoom it, you will see there is a difference over here. So this particular connectivity is an active lineage, and this is actually not active. There is a link category ID to category ID, but it is not active. So it might happen sometimes. What you can do is you can connect one table with another table in multiple ways. I will just show you in over here. So let's first of all make this as active. So now I will just give you an example over here. So now suppose we have required date, we have order date, and we have ship date. Now if I want to connect these dates, and if I want to slice and dice based on this date, definitely what you need to do is you need to create connectivity with all these three. So you cannot spare any one of these dates, and it has to be. So at any point of time, you can have one active relation, but at the same time you need to have you can have multiple inactive relations as well. So we will see that in this particular module itself. So talking about the cardinality, there is something else also which is talking about the hierarchy. So hierarchy building is also a part of the DAX benefit. So you can see that over here. So if you go to the orders table, and when you go to order date, so by default you will see that it creates a hierarchy. So the hierarchy is for year, called hierarchy structure of any date that comes in Power BI. However, we can also create our own hierarchy. So I'll just give you one simple example. You have, let's say, country, and you have city, let's say. So these two we want to capture, or let's take an example. If I may just go to customers table, so customers table, we have city and country. So all of them have city and country. Maybe if you were to have zone and other things also. So how it works, I'll just show you. So if you just right click on this customer country, there's an option which says create hierarchy. So it creates a hierarchy based on customer country. And now you will see that customer country is there as a hierarchy over here. So customer country hierarchy. Now what you want is, suppose I want to create I want to insert city into this hierarchy. I will tell you what is the reason. So you say add hierarchy, and you say customer country hierarchy. So now what happens is I can just rename this. Right. So we can call it as customer hierarchy, like this. So what happens is, whenever you are working on any visual which requires drill down, so you will see that you have two options. You can manually also put the hierarchy within a visual, but to maintain standard, what you can do is you can always take up a hierarchy over here, and then whenever you work with customer hierarchy, it will automatically focus on country and city. So step by step, when we see visualization, we will see this in active mode. Okay. After we do modeling, in the process of there are two things that happens. One is the regular data modeling, and another one is the exploratory data modeling. So exploratory data modeling means, with the same model, you try to create different relations and let's say the measures and other things that you create for different sets of tables to see the visualization, how it reacts actually with your data model. So there is an exploratory one and there is a regular data modeling that happens as well. So let's take an example of the multi-dimensional data model that Power BI supports. So when you do any kind of project using your Power BI, so you will see that there is this four layers. The first layer becomes the source layer. So source layer, what happens is all your raw data points, be it data coming from SQL or be it coming from Dynamics 365, it's coming from Oracle, Cassandra, MongoDB, it can come from any source. So what happens is they all sit in the first layer called source layer. Now what happens is you have two more layers between the presentation layer. So the second layer is analytical layer. This is the semantic layer, what we call it. So here we discuss that whether our data will be ingested through a live connection or it will be ingested through an import or direct query. So now very, very simple to understand. If your data is huge, so in that case, you might be requiring the live connection, which is in the form of a cube. That's what we saw in terms of Google Analytics. So it was huge data. So Google Analytics is huge data. So it is not possible to import entire Google Analytics query and tables and then run a visualization or something. It is like not possible. So in that case, we use an OLAP. However, if this particular data is small in size, but maybe a bit complex and you have to perform various calculations to build up this particular model, in that case, we use the import method, or at times we can have the direct query method also. I will show you where to mention import or direct query. So we have seen that in terms of SQL Server data ingestion as well. So something like this. Then comes the BI engine, where most of the tasks will be done by Power BI in terms of creating the data model, detecting the relationship. But there could be some additional tasks that you might have to take up in terms of working with the data. The final set will be the presentation layer. So presentation layer, what happens is you actually visualize all the data and also the sharing of the data happens in this presentation layer. So the basic techniques are, if we put it in a nutshell, so understanding the functionalities and see that whether we require a gateway or not. So that is also an important section, a part over here. Then we see how to build up that multi-dimensional data visualization model that we have to see. Components of the Power BI chart. So these are the things that we are going to learn. And how do we see data how do you visualize data, especially when it is a geographical data kind of thing. So we have discussed about the snowflakes and the other complex schemas. So we can always see that there are databases which belongs to snowflakes as well. So we will now move on to the introduction of DAX. So how the DAX works, how is the function working, and what is the context, the row context and the filter context that we talked about. So filtering or aggregation. So these are the two things that we need to work with. So one talks about the filter context, which is the filtering, and filtering can be again two. It could be either implicit or explicitly you are declaring the filtering, or it could be directly within the function as well. A typical DAX syntax would look something like this. So it will have different sections. So starting from, you start with the DAX name and then you put the other section. So let's have a quick look at it. So this is the name of the measure that you give, followed by an equal to sign just to assign. Then you have the name of the function that you are using. So most of the cases you will find a similarity with your Excel functions as well. And then you will see there is a reference table that comes up. So this is the entire DAX actually, which is surrounded the expression, what we call, this is the expression part. And in expression, we have the first part, which is the table reference. And the second part is the column reference. So which table, which column are you referring? What do you want to do? And then where you want to store. So that's all with the DAX expressions actually. So there are essential DAX functions, which we are going to see in detail. So there are date, time functions, there are information functions, math functions, filter functions, logical functions, and statistical functions as well. So let's move on to an activity. So this is the most important activity before we jump on to the measures part. So what we need to do is, we have this particular data set. So as a part of this activity, what we are going to learn over here is, usually when you are creating measures, so because measures can be created for various columns and various tables, so it is not fixed somewhere. So what you need to do is, we go to this, we need to create a container for this. So let's see, how do we create a container? So to do this, what you need to do is, we go to home and then we create on this option called create a new table. And under new table, we go to this place and we just say underscore measures. And why do we say underscore measures? Because if you just say measures, then you might have 300, 400 tables across this particular model. And M, so it is in alphabetical order, as you can see. So M will get somewhere down. So to make this container float at the top, because this is the most important part of the entire model, that's why we are just giving it as underscore. So if I just say load, see what happens. It sets at the top. So it will sit at the top. And according to Codd's rule, every table need to have at least one column or attribute. That's why by default it has given this column one. However, when you start creating your measures, so this can be negated and removed as well. So this is the activity that we wanted to focus on in this particular channel, in this particular section over here. So we will move on to the next section, wherein we will be talking about how to create this calculated columns and all these things in detail we will be seeing. So I just save it, and we just saw how this part works actually. I mean, how the measure container is created. So that's the end of part 1 for module 5. See you in the next module.